Hey, Mo. The national anthem. Yeah, just make that one take.
It's on those, it's on the live video. Islam, Islam, just see it, brother. Yeah, just have a seat. Islam, Islam, welcome. Islam, we're just talking about 2 minutes. All right. Islam, we have our national Sunday school service. We have a lot of folks that's on the conference call across the country, as well as our live video feed via YouTube. And we welcome you. We're going to be starting just in a few clicks. Those that's on the conference call line, we just ask that you mute your phone. This is Sunday school, so sometimes we do have open dialogue questions that we could definitely address. If you don't have a question, we just ask that you mute your phone. And those who's watching our live video feed via YouTube, you can just post your questions in the live chat. We do have people there that can translate your message to us and allow us to address that once we open up for our Sunday school service. Again, we welcome you to Temple Number 5, Moorish Center of America, 1928. I'm Grand Governor Isis Sadio.
Raise our meeting. It's National Sunday School. Today is the 17th of February, 2019, and in the year of Ali, 133. Fall will rise. Feet at a 45 degree angle. Two on the right, five on the left, representation of our law. And repeat after me, I pray. Allah, Father of the universe.
Allah, Father of the universe.
The Father of love,
Father of love,
truth,
truth,
peace.
Peace.
Freedom.
Freedom.
And justice.
And justice.
Allah is my protector.
Allah is my protector.
My guide.
My guide.
And my salvation.
And my salvation.
By night.
By night.
And by day.
And by day.
Through his holy prophet.
Through his holy prophet.
Drew Ali.
Drew Ali.
Amen.
Amen.
Islam.
Islam.
Islam, 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 Islam. This is a wonderful day. We give praise and thanks to Allah for bringing us this thus far. We know that Allah is the creator of all, started in creating of all things, seen and unseen, known and unknown. And we give him praise for that honor. We also give honors to our prophet. His prophet, his selection, who he prepared in divine in due time. Prophet Noble Drew Ali. We also give honors to the Harbinger, who we affectionately refer to as the Harbinger, Saint Marcus Messiah God, who said, "Up you mighty nation, accomplish what you will." We give honors to the prophet's selection of the first supreme grand sheik, who we affectionately refer to as Saint Edward Mealy Hill. And we give honors to all supreme grand sheiks in the lineage, up to and including our present day supreme grand sheik, who we affectionately call Chief of Ministers, Dr. Ross Adier. Islam?
Islam.
We give honors to all governors, sheikhs, sheikhesses, adepts, members, family, friends alike. And we also give honors to the enemy of truth. Because without a foe, this soldier would never know his strength.
Islam.
Islam. Now, when it becomes quite clear that a certain person is the true prophet of Allah, the natural result of this realization is that his word should be accepted, his instructions followed, and his orders obeyed. It is unreasonable to accept a man as Allah's true prophet and yet not believe in what he says or not follow what he ordains. Your acceptance of him as Allah's prophet means you have acknowledged that what he says is from Allah Almighty, and that whatever he does is in accordance with Allah's will and pleasure. Now, disobedience to him is the disobedience of Allah. And disobedience of Allah leads to nothing but ruin and devastation. Therefore, the very acceptance of the prophet makes it incumbent upon you to bow to his instructions and accept them without any hesitation whatsoever. Now, you may not be able to fully grasp the wisdom of this or that order, but the fact that an instruction came from the prophet is sufficient guarantee for its truth. There can be no room for doubt or suspicion. Your inability to understand, it is no reason for its having flaw or defect, because a common man's understanding is not flawless. It has its limitations, and they cannot be ignored altogether. Islam?
Islam.
Salvation, Allah, unity. More Science Temple of America, Divine Constitution and Bylaws. Act 1. The Grand Chief and the Chairman of the More Science Temple of America is empowered to make law and enforce laws with the assistance of the Prophet and the Grand Body of the More Science Temple of America. The Assistant Grand Chief is to assist the Grand Chief in all affairs, if he lives according to love, truth, peace, freedom, and justice, and it is known before the members of the Moorish Science Temple of America. Act 2. All meetings are to be opened and closed promptly according to the Circle 7 and love, truth, peace, freedom, and justice. Friday is our holy day of rest, because on a Friday the first man was formed in flesh, and on a Friday the first man departed out of flesh and ascended unto his Father God, Allah. For that cause, Friday is the holy day for all Muslims all over the world. Act 3. Love, truth, peace, freedom, and justice must be proclaimed and practiced by all members of the Moorish Science Temple of America. No member is to put in danger or accuse falsely his brother or sister on any occasion at all, that they may harm his brother or sister, because Allah is love. Act 4. All members must preserve these holy and divine laws, and all members must obey the laws of the government, because by being a Moorish American, you are a part and parcel of the government and must live the life accordingly. Act 5. This organization of the Moorish Science Temple of America is not to cause any confusion or to overthrow the laws and constitution of the said government, but to obey hereby. Act 6. With us, all members must proclaim their nationality, and we are teaching our people their nationality and their divine creed, that they may know that they are a part and parcel of this said government, and know that they are not Negroes, colored folk, black people, or Ethiopians, because these names were given to slaves by slaveholders in 1779 and lasted until 1865, during the time of slavery. But this is a new era of time now, and all men now must proclaim their free national name to be recognized by the government in which they live and the nations of the earth. This is the reason why Allah, the great God of the universe, ordained Noble Duali, the prophet, to redeem his people from their sinful ways. The Moorish Americans are descendants of the ancient Moabites, whom inhabited the northwestern and southwestern shores of Africa. Act 7. All members must promptly attend their meetings and become a part and a partial of all uplifting acts of the Moorish Science Temple of America. Members must pay their dues and keep in line with all necessities of the Moorish Science Temple of America. Then you're entitled to the name of faith. Husband, you must support your wife and children. Wife, you must obey your husband and take care of your children and look after the duties of your household. Sons and daughters must obey father and mother and be industrious and become a part of the uplifting of fallen humanity. All Moors must keep their hearts and minds pure with love and their bodies clean with water. This divine covenant is from your holy prophet, Noble Juwali, through the guidance of his father, God Allah. Noble Juwali is the founder of the Moor Science Temple of America, Islam. Now, before I yield the podium, we started on the subject last Sunday school, and so we're gonna open the door to the room and go into the room of the mind of fleshless things and discuss some more on contrast and comparison. I like that phrase, contrast and comparison, because it carries a significance, and the significance is this. And I like to speak, well, we like to speak from our own personal experience. Coming from the secular world, we experience the education of the European nation. And we studied behavioral health, criminal justice or criminology, and we also studied psychology. And we received our degrees as they would give, bachelor, master, and was working on a doctorate. Got to be a little taxing because certain things was taking place within an individual, this individual. I come to call it cognitive dissonance, which means, and I'll give the meaning, that this discomfort is triggered by a situation in which a person's belief crashes with new evidence perceived by that person. It causes mental discomfort. That's what I like to call it, mental discomfort. My queen mother talks about cognitive dissonance on a number of occasions in her cookbook lessons. But this person holds two or more contradictory beliefs, ideas, or values. That's why there's a cognitive discomfort in this person. That is what I referred to when it was time for me to make a change. So in making this change and coming to the Moorish Science Temple of America, Allah blessed me with some good teachers. I mean, outstanding teachers. Now, I have a good judgment of teachers, being in school some 25, 26 years, and learning the secular world's education system and mastering it, so to speak. And coming to the Moorish Science Temple of America, the first thing that I was told, well, I'm gonna put it like this. First thing I was told, they said, empty your cup. So I broke mine and came in with the hammer. I came back with the next class with the hammer. And they glued me a new cup on and they put some new things in it. But before they put those things in, they say, look, this is what you're gonna have to do. When you wanna make you a cup of tea, we all like tea. And this is your cup of tea. So when you get ready to make you a cup, get you another cup, you take this sifter and sift through the tea, or your tea, and mix it with this tea, or sift through what you have, and sift through this, or other ingredients you wanna put in, and sift through it, and if anything falls through, or is caught, what's caught, you discard. What falls through, you keep. So, in saying that, certain things that I learned in the secular education, I kept. Other things I had to get rid of. Islam. What we have been experiencing this past year, and culminated with the Hajj that my chief of ministers and I went on to Mecca just earlier this month, was life-changing, life-altering, and very pleasant. But it also heightened awareness that there are certain things happening in the Moorish Divine National Movement. Moors are at odds with other Moors, with certain things going on. This is that. Supreme Grand Sheik, this. They throwing it all out here in the cyberspace, and you know, they got the virtual temples, and you can't see anyone else in there, you don't hear anyone else in there, but you know, when you're at a temple, there's people there other than just that one individual. And when you were discussing, you were discussing things as the prophet brought, not your own understanding of it, but as you are taught. I like that word. In contrast and comparison, I also found that something takes place when a person starts looking at past events and these new perceived events. Notice the word perceived, because what you see may not always be what it be. It may be something else. This causes what they call an enigma. And the enigma is a puzzling event. You become puzzled. Is it this way? Is it that way? But I've come to find out through my teachers that if you stick to the prophet's teaching, if you teach, if you stick to what is taught and was divinely prepared and given to our prophet by Allah Almighty, you can't go wrong. Let me give an example. Can everyone hear me? Okay, let's do the mic. There we go. All right. I'm going to start with one piece of information, the warning. And I'm going to start, and I'm going to read it down. It says, the end of time is drawing near. So says Allah to his divine prophet, I, Noble Drew Ali. No mistake there. I, Noble Drew Ali. This is what he received. And this is what he has passed on to the Moors. And that is why many hearts have been turned to stone, and many have eyes to see, but cannot see. Remember that word perceived? Okay, there we go, right there. But cannot, ears to hear, but cannot hear. Because some people can see with their ears as well. You hear, what is that? Sounds like something coming that way. Oh, get out the way. Or someone blows a horn, you're crossing the street. Chief refers to it, some people can't even cross the street correctly. So you hear that horn, you have to stop, take another turn. Least they would be confounded of their sins. These are trying hours now, dear Moors, and every evil spirit is moving, and they are trying every weak mind to overthrow and drag out the true foundation that has been laid and to cause confusion in the minds of the ones that do believe. But if you have the true love of Allah and the spirit of your forefathers, you fear not what you hear or see, but you will sacrifice the utmost of your very life to protect your movement and your prophet. Watch your enemy, dear, your enemies, dear Moors. Your enemies are the ones that speak against your prophet and ridicule him to the very lowest, and the ones that speak against your divine and national principles of your temples. Act accordingly, and Allah will bless you for your good work. And ends with peace, your divine prophet, Noble Drew Ali. Some Moors speak about I'm a Moor, I was born a Moor, I ain't gotta be in the temple to be a Moor, and that's not what the prophet said. If you look into our, what the divine constitution and bylaws that I just read, it tells you that all members must do this and that and other, right on down the line. Again, to be a practicing Moor, must be attached to a temple. And you must be learning, as the warning says. Let's go right to it so we won't move through. Your divine and national principles. Also, he gave something else. 101s and 102s. He gave his oral statements, Moorish literature, and he gave us this pamphlet. Some Moors refer to it as a book. It's a pamphlet. Has good information in there. And I'm saying what is in the book, what is in the pamphlet. I am a prophet, and the servant is worthy of his hire. You can receive this pamphlet at expense. Whatever expense it costs to make it, that's what expense can be taken for. But I think we give ours freely when you join the temple. My point is this. In contrast of comparison of a Muslim Moor and the enigma is simple. Stick to what the prophet brought. Abide by the divine, your divine and national principles that he set forth, that he set forth for the temples. Then act accordingly to that. Contrast and comparison, it won't take long to see if you line up with what's according to the law or not. That will bring unity of the person, that mental discomfort that's called cognitive dissonance will be less and less, and an individual will be able to walk as a Muslim or more, or Moorish Muslim, the way you want to put it. Thing is, you'll be on the right and direct path. That's acting accordingly. And there's a promise there. Act accordingly, and Allah will bless you for your good work. Peace. That ends my demonstration. We'll bring forth our governors, grand governors, Isis Adiel, Islam.
Islam, 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 praise Allah.
Islam.
Allahu Akbar.
Allahu Akbar.
Islam, Islam. We are truly, truly blessed that Allah has allowed us and bestowed upon us having another day to experience the glory in knowing him, to allow these divine lessons to be our lifelong blessings. And in giving praises to our Father God, Allah, the Father of the world, the seen and unseen, the governor of all is, the creator of all of love, love. We humble ourselves in complete submission in praising the only one who's deserving of praise, our Father God, Allah. We give honors to our prophet, whom our Father God, Allah, blessed us with in giving us understanding. He has been our gift in extending the understanding, these divine lessons, our relationship in knowing ourselves, our relationships with each other, but most importantly, our relationship in returning us back to that divine understanding and that oneness, and knowing, key one, who made us. And understanding that true concept of who made us, thus we can continue on the journey having a more pure idea and conception of who we are in relationship, not only to ourselves, but to our Father God, Allah. So our prophet came to rid us from those measures that have instigated the cognitive dissonance of our people in attaining and attaching the titles of names of scorn of Negro, Black, Colored, and a whole bunch of other names that are not that in our DNA, that is contrary of who we are. And so in that, because Allah made no Negro, Black, or Colored person, so we can identify and actually connect who made us when Allah didn't make us. So thus we had to realize who we were as a people, and knowing that Allah created us in nations and tribes, and understanding that measure in which Allah has made us, then connect us to who we are in our history and our relationship with each other. And get it? And again, our relationship with our Father God Allah. We give honors to our Prophet for being that conduit and connecting us back to that divine idea. We give honors to Mark Messiah Garvey, for he was too divinely prepared in due time by our Father God Allah. It was Mark Messiah Garvey that set the stage for our Prophet, for the world to see him. It was Mark Messiah Garvey demonstrating a day he had on a white turban and said that it's going to be a man to come to you tomorrow, to someone that I can't lace up his shoes. Mark Messiah Garvey respected and understood the divinity by which our Prophet was coming. And thus we honor him, because he honored our Prophet. We give honors to the first Supreme Grand Sheik appointed by our beloved Prophet Noble Jar Ali, as we affectionately call, because even Martin Messiah Garvey said we should canonize our own. And so we extended Emilio into the ranks of sainthood, as our Prophet initiated and appointed Emilio, Saint Emilio, as being the first Supreme Grand Sheik of the Moorish Scientific America. So in respecting and carrying on that beautiful lineage and that direct connection to the Prophet itself, from Emilio to Williams Morrison Ill to P. Davis Ill to Waleed Nayembe to our present patriarch, our Sheikh was on the fifth Supreme Grand Sheik appointed October 2010 Sheikh Ras Adil. We give honors to all past leaders, all those who held fast, and those that continue to hold fast, the leaderships, the members, the friends, sympathizers, all those that fall in that beautiful idea of the crescent and star of Islam. We extend to you in the Moorish American greeting to and from. I say Islam, Islam, Islam. I'm Grand Governess Isis Adil, and you are at Temple Number 5 here in Lithonia, Georgia. And we want to extend Islam's to Grand Sheikh Yusuf Muhammad Bey for that demonstration. I'm just going to give a small measure, and this is our National Sunday School, and we definitely want to extend a greater time for our national leadership to speak, because we have our temples and members across the country that are listening via our phone lines, as well as our live video feed via YouTube. So we want to extend our Islams to even our guests that have thought the need to participate, perhaps hear a word or two that will incite and invoke critical thinking for you to reflect on your present concerns and ideas. And if it's in relationship and being connected to the divinity, to the divine understanding of having a purpose, serving a greater purpose. And so we hope that you being here, whether you're physically here or listening via the phone or watching us via the live stream, that something is instigated deep within you to activate not only a critical thinking, but that thinking will result in a outwardly show in you being of service to a greater measure to the only one who's deserving of all our service, and that's our Father God Allah. One of the things in dealing with the Moor Science Temple of America, and often enough, folks will take sound bites, particularly with the Prophet's teachings, and not follow it up with the whole meal. They just give you a sample, not really giving you the whole essence of the meal. So a lot of times there, we hear a lot of sample teachings. And sometimes it's unfulfilling and also can leave a huge gap, which will cause a lot of ambiguity, you know, a lot of assumptions. And so our Prophet gave his measure plain and clear as to his directions, his instructions. Now understand this, as Moorish Americans, we have to look at ourselves as being truly blessed. We have to look at ourselves as being truly blessed, because we was giving the divine instructions during the time of our Prophet being in the physical. See, it wasn't like decades after his untimely death that somehow there has been this group of Moorish American Muslim come together and start nitpicking what they felt should be construed and compiled to be our religious text. Our Prophet put it together where there is not a word lost, or not anything misunderstood, because not only did he give us a Quran, but he also gave us caveats. He gave us instructions. He gave us a direct measure, a method, and how we should perceive as being, living, claiming, representing, and being supportive of the Moor Science Temple of America and the divine idea that comes behind the support of being a Moorish American Muslim. Our prophet didn't leave anything to be misunderstood. We had a beautiful prophet that gave it plain and clear. He even went to the point of instigating what we call open-ended questions. Questions where he gave, like with our 101s and the 102s, these questions were to initiate our own furtherance and investigation so that we become what we know and not just simply verbiating something that someone told us. So when we look at key one, who made you, and thus the answer being Allah, now what's in between who made you and Allah? Now that is an investigative mind. Now I have to go into religious texts to fill that void in so I can give a more furtherance in explaining who made me. Because Allah surely didn't make a Negro, Black, colored, or African American. So we have to fill in the gaps. And in having that, our prophet gave us a divine constitution and bylaws. And even in key one, he left the direction and caveats that we have guides. So that tends to look at the fact that it eliminates anyone coming up and stepping and taking the threshold as being a Moorish leader if you're not attached to what the prophet has brought. You can't self-proclaim yourself as being a Moorish leader, historian, or someone in the temple, or just simply waking up one day, slapping yourself in the head and claiming I'm a Moorish American without following the dictates what has already been established. We can't do that. But somehow it seems that folks think that you can do that in the Moorish Temple of America because no one is pointing fingers, no one is checking anybody. Because we became complacent of those vast ideas and misconceptions of what the Moorish Temple of America is about. So too often, and for many years and decades, we gave lead way to folks stepping up and making certain claims and not checking them. Because now when you check in someone, there's this misunderstanding that somehow they're using the words of the prophet and the teachings out of context. When you hear more checking someone about a group of Moors claiming to be following the teachings of the prophet, and we saying the Great Seal is not part of the Moor Sign Temple of America, that's a usurpist idea. That's in contrast to what the prophet brought. And now you have other Moors saying, well, you're speaking radical against other Moors. The prophet said, don't do that. But here's the thing. When you ask someone, what is the definition of radical? Because that's what you have to do. You have to define it. Because often enough, you can't assume. And that's one of our greatest measures our teacher gave us. Never assume someone has the same understanding as you. So sometimes you got to give it back to them. Let me make it plain and clear. What does radical mean? Can we get somebody with some dictionaries and pull it up? Because I have the definition in my head. So those that's on the phone lines, those that's watching via the YouTube video, pull up radical. Because let's get this conception about this idea clear. Because too often enough, people are claiming that as Moorish Americans, the prophet said you're not to speak radical about other Moorish Americans. That's not what the prophet said. That is not what he said. And when the prophet made that statement that Moorish Americans should not speak radical against, and I'm paraphrasing, other groups, other ideas and conceptions as outside of the temple. We're not supposed to be speaking radical against the European. Because at one time, the teachings was it ignited a sense of race pride for the Moors. They know who they were, but now they're going around telling the European, oh, you the blue-eyed devil, and you this and that. Oh, 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 prophet said, hold on, hold on. Hey, we can't be talking out against a social norm for somebody else. See, talking radical is being where you are emphatically opposed to a social norm, idea, or condition. That's what radical means, is that you are diametrically opposed to a particular social norm, idea, or condition. And in you being diametrically opposed to that, you're speaking out against it. But here's the thing, our prophet told us we used to be about our business, let them be about theirs. We're not supposed to speaking about how somebody else is running their government when we're supposed to be running ours. So for me to speak out radical against those who are not part of the more scientific or America concept ideas, the caveats falling under the dictates in which our prophet is laid, that's not speaking radical in that sense, because I'm speaking against the liar. I'm speaking it against the contrast that is against what our prophet has taught. Now, Jim, we don't have the crowd saying Islam, but can I get an Islam on that?
Islam.
Praise Allah. So when we're speaking radical, it's only become radical to the idea of someone that's trying to harvest an improper concept or nature that's against what the prophet has brought. Truth telling has always seemed radical to those who want to be living in evil. Truth telling has always been radical to the ideas that is against someone doing what's right. See, when Jesus was demonstrating to the Hindus, and this is in your Circle 7 Quran, he had a crowd. Somebody put out a nice promotional measure because Jesus had it going on. You had people from all caste systems coming out to hear him demonstrate. And when he started speaking, you know, all the folks was like, they heard rumors that this guy was damned. Now, before he started speaking, everybody was on board. I want to hear what he got to say. Y'all heard he was good. And then he started laying down the truth. And so you had some people there who was offended by what Jesus was saying because it was attacking their immoral nature. It was attacking that devil within them. So now they're saying, oh, he's speaking of the devil. He has the tongue of the devil. What is he saying? But then you had some people that was there that said, man, he got the tongue of the gods. He's speaking like the gods. He's speaking truth. They was cheering him on. So he had a mixed crowd. And often enough, you will find yourself amongst mixed ideas and conceptions. So the radical teachings only became radical to those who was against the truth. Because someone who is living a dirty life, someone who's got comfortable in chaos, someone who's got comfortable in immorality, someone that comfortable in doing nothing but wrong, that someone got comfortable in confusion, misunderstanding, leading people astray, running amok, when someone's got comfortable with that infused idea of nonsense, then when Jesus was pointing it out, yes, it became radical to them because Jesus is trying to change their condition. He's talking against the society and the norms of the immorality that they have given themselves as being truth. So let's get this clear. What is radical? And the only ones that speak out and say to another Moorish American, you speaking radical, now I gotta ask how you living. If you tell another Moorish American that's talking truth against the evils of a society that he's a part of, we're talking in-house now. I'm not talking outside the Moorish Scientific America. My concerns is not with Donald Trump. My concerns is where I'm at, where I give my life to, where I'm fixed at. I'm concerned with what breathed the holy name within me, what put fire under my feet. I'm concerned with the Moorish Science Temple of America. This is my home. So when we speak out against those who claim jumping, false flagging, it's only radical because they want to get a pass on their evil. So let's get it straight. Don't never assume that someone understands what you're talking about when it comes to the teachings of the prophet. Give it back to them. Tell them to make it clear. Write it down. Talk to me like I'm a two-year-old. Make it simple. I'm going to close with this. There's also another misconception in the Moorish Science Temple of America, and that's often verbiated throughout social media. And it's become somewhat a agitating idiom, a catchphrase, if you will, because it's been taken out of context and it has been disseminated as a point to deflect the evils of others. And what is that phrase? And we don't say it in the Moorish Science of America 1928. You won't hear in other art temples and study groups and our members verbiating this phrase, because we understand who it was said to, why it was said, and the purpose and the nature in which it was said by our prophet. Our teacher, we have a bound teacher, he down. Sheikh Rasadil ain't no joke. He ain't make no dummies here. He ain't gonna claim nobody that's a dummy.
That's right.
We got a strong teacher.
That's right.
Now, when the prophet said to the Moors, and the Moors turned it into a catchphrase, you need to learn to love instead of hate. Crickets, wait a minute. Wait. That's it? That's all you giving me? What comes before and after that? What did the prophet say in context to you need to learn to love instead of hate? And often enough, this is being said by so-called Moorish Americans to other Moorish Americans out of context. Because when you take the phrase and you can go into your Circle 7 Quran, it says the fallen sons and daughters of the Asiatic nations of North America need to come to learn to love instead of hate. The fallen sons and daughters of the Asiatic states of North America need to come to learn to love instead of hate. I don't see anywhere in there where it says Moor or Moorish American or Muslim. Because once I step over the threshold of becoming a Moorish American by taking my Shahadatain, my declaration of faith saying that there is no God but Allah, there's only but one Father God, Allah, all my life and my contribution to everything that I am is to Allah Almighty God. And then I say that Prophet Noble Juali, but without a doubt of contradiction, is a prophet of Allah. And that my life will be exceedingly reflecting what I'm about and who I am, living the faith of Islam. Who made you?
Allah.
What's your way?
Islam.
Who's your prophet?
Ali.
That's your question and the answers to a Moorish American Muslim. And when Allah gave me that measure, I stepped across the threshold in accepting it 100, giving my life worth to it. Yet I would die for this. And once I've gotten that idea, I'm no longer hating myself anymore, because I know who the hell I am. So stop telling me you need to learn to love instead of hate. Stop verbiating that idea if you don't know what the hell you're talking about. Give me some substance. Give me the beginning and the end of it. Who are you? Who are you? Who made you?
Allah.
I leave you as I come in peace and love and praise Allah. I call up my teacher, Sheikh Rasadi.
Islam.
Islam, Islam, Islam. Be seated.
I rise in perfect praises to Allah, Father, universe, Father, seen and unseen, known and unknown, giving high honors to Allah in the person of none other than Jordan, our prophet, our savior, your savior. Islam, 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 I count back all honors given before. Islam, we get right into my lesson. You know, Islam. I started thinking like this before. So I'm going with what she just said. Who do you identify with? If you say you're more, you got to identify with him. But you got to identify him to who's teaching you about him. Because how do you know him? Unless somebody teach you about him. Let me give you some examples. My wife gave me a lesson today. And I was like amazed. I thought I knew it. She said, baby, what verse in the Bible is where Jesus told Peter, get behind me, Satan? I said, you know, Mark 3, verse 38 through 44. She said, yeah, well, he said, but baby, son, I said, no, that can't be Mark 3. She said, it's not Mark 3, it's Mark 8, 33. Somebody give me a Bible. I went, no, I got it right here. I'm gonna read it to you. I want you to call this lesson is because it falls on the shoulders of Moors. This is a lesson that falls on the shoulders of those who call themselves Moors. The prophet said some of my good Moors are still in church. Now I'm gonna use this as Mo taught me, she used it. We said as Mecca. On the heart, she said, I was telling about one of my teachers. You got it?
Yes, sir. Okay, wait. Mark 8.
Mark 8, 33. Wait a minute. So I was telling about my teacher when I was in prison. And I didn't have no GED, and I've been trying to get my GED. I couldn't get it. And so this year, this particular year, I'm in prison. So I'm in Vienna, Illinois. And they take you around from room to room when you're there. When you first get there. Find out what teacher you would like to be under. And we went back into this room. This guy was talking like, yeah, whoa, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Yeah, ABC. And so they took us in his room. We looked, and it was this guy. And it had to be about 50 seats in the room, but one by 2, 3 people there. And I was looking at this 1, 2 people there. And I'm like, wow. And he's talking loud. And so we sit down. And he's talking. He said, anybody got? I said, yeah, I got a question. He said, what's that? Why are you talking so loud? Ain't nobody in here. He said, you don't see nobody. He said, my room is full. And I was explaining to him how the guy looked. His name was, we called him Mr. Rutherford. Now, Mr. Rutherford was about 5'7", 5'9", in between there. Mr. Rutherford wore thicker glasses than I got on. But the thing that got me when I'm looking at him, he got a plaid jacket on. He got like red, like a modern day garden flag on him in his coat. Cause it's red, black, and green. But he got pinstripe pants on. And I'm looking at him, he got pinstripe pants on. And I'm like, plaids and stripes? But then he got a red shirt on with a funny looking bow tie. And he walking across this tunnel, And so when we left out the room, we went and the teacher started asking what class was. I said, I want Mr. Rutherford. See, you want Mr. Rutherford? I said, yeah, I can learn from Mr. Rutherford. Because Mr. Rutherford has showed me what a teacher is. A teacher is teaching. He don't get many people in the room. To him, it's full. To him, it's full. So I learned. That's how I got my GED in English. I can't say hardly nothing right in English now. But hey, I got my GED. And you don't need but 245 points. When I got my GED, I had 375 points. I had the highest point in the whole of the prison ministry in the state at that time. Because I had good teachers.
You got the spirit of the lesson.
Yeah, I got good teachers. So read that to me. This is Mark 8, verse 33. What does it say?
But when he had turned about and looked on his disciples,
he rebuked Peter, saying, "Get thee behind me, Satan, for thou savorest not the things that be of God, but the things that be of men."
Israel, now check it. This is another time in the teachings of Mark that he said Jesus checked Peter, and Peter was the rock. Sometimes when you check your right-hand man, he get mad.
You hurt my feelings.
He turned evil. You know, well, brother, why you get this? Why you keep talking about that?
You hurt my feelings. I'm a grown man.
But Peter is the rock. When you read the Bible, Peter is one of the Jesus that should be in my church about. But Peter had to also master himself, because a rock sit on something. It got to sit on a sure foundation. But Jesus tell Peter, in the chapter before Mark 9, he said, "Peter, you following me. Here I am before you, but you following them damn fools." You know how many damn fools are following damn fools today? I had this thing last night. I had to wake up. And I was thinking about these fools that call themselves the Moorish counseling under Taj Tariq and them. And I was there, and the sister was talking. My wife had showed it to me last night. I said, "Baby, look at this sister here." Yes, and I had to teach them. And I'm like, we're going to challenge that. But it's the idea, if you, the person that God want to work with, that's what Jesus is saying. I want to work with you, Peter. I want to raise you up, Peter. I want to raise your nature. I want you to master your Lord self, Peter. I want to raise you up, Peter, from man to God-like man, Peter. But Peter's still caught up in his sin. Let me give you a better example. We were driving up here today, coming up here, and we almost had an accident because ISIS is talking, and I'm talking, and there's a guy panhandling for money, right? Have y'all ever seen that up here in Georgia on the highway, people panhandling for money? How many of y'all have seen that?
Oh, yeah.
Let me ask you, why in the hell they in front of the church? Let me ask you an intelligent question. You get on any highway in Georgia, I'm guaranteed 2-3 blocks, there's 15 churches.
Yes.
There's 100 churches. Why are they panhandling on the highway? But you go to church, and the man in the church said, "I need $65 million for a new airplane. Because this $20 million airplane they got, it don't look as good as the $65 million. And then he say, "God said, give it to me." So now you give this man $65 million for an airplane, right? Now this same man, you walk up to say, "Oh, Pastor, oh, you know, my life's going to cut off. We'll talk to Jesus." You know, talk to Jesus. Go ask God. See, if you've been paying your tithe, God see it, and God will give you a check. But God don't make money. That's how Moors is. That's why the prophet say some of my good Moors still in church. We're still thinking like Christians. We're so thinking like Christians. Anybody can be a man of God. Right now, you're going to Christian church. I would right now, in the Atlanta area, there got to be at least 5 prophets. There got to be at least 5 prophets in the Atlanta, Georgia area. I think some prophetess just got her booty whooped by the prophet at the hotel, and he beat her down. She be on television. The one with the big white chin, the big background. This Juanita other guy, Bynum. Huh?
Is it Juanita Bynum?
One of them got their butt whooped, a prophet whooped the prophetess. Now this other guy, who used to be with the European, what's that guy? Orwell, the one in Texas, the guy at the mega church. He got this brother. He taught this brother. The brother came out. He got a mega church. He just brought his wife a Lamborghini. Y'all don't hear me. He just brought his wife a Lamborghini, a $200,000 car, for people on the highway begging for him. How many times you think that Lamborghini gonna stop on the highway and issue out some money to the people begging? Think about it. This shows you something. We Moors have adopted the Christian idea. ways and by ways, begging instead of teaching. Mm-hmm. The prophet said, now this is the answer to the question that my wife put out there. What comes before? Learn to love instead of hate. What comes before that? Anyone has ordination paper that says this at the bottom. It says that you're to go out, ministers to go out and teach men upon the hedges and out to repent from their sinful ways. Then it says a period. So I'm supposed to go out in the hedges and highway and teach you to repent from your sinful ways. Then it says that you may come to learn to love instead of hate. You can't learn to love instead of hate until you stop sinning. You can't stop sinning if you're in the club and you said, I'm a Muslim. You got this nationality card in your pocket, but you saying you're a Muslim. Look, I got mine. But you're saying you're a Muslim. What the hell are you doing in the club? You know? You in the club telling somebody else you're a Muslim. But why in the hell are you in the club getting a free drink? Now in Detroit, I know some people in Detroit, if you got a nationality card, you get a discount at the booty club. You get a discount at the wet t-shirt club. I'm talking about what I know. So now, what happened? Get all my stuff together. What happens? I got boop boop. Blow that up, Mo. Blow that up.
Yeah. Islam.
See this? This is one of my I'm 68 this year. This is one of my original nationality cards. Still in my pocket. Crumpled up within my pocket. What that guy said on the TV? Played in the Jedi movie. The one that says, what's in your wallet?
Samuel Jackson.
Samuel Jackson, what's in your damn wallet? That's right. Huh?
What's in your wallet?
What's in, identify with your, what's in your wallet. Mm. See, mine, I get credit back from my wallet. You have to wonder. I was talking to a young boy today. I was coming up here and he was talking about, yeah, the treaty law, such and such. I said, what treaty law are you talking about, brother? The treaty of peace and friendship. I said, brother, where you get that from? Well, you know, the more such and such, you know, bro, I say, who told you that? Berates. What do you mean? The prophet, I said, is not in the Quran. The Peace and Friendship Treaty of 1787 was here before the prophet was born in 1886. So in 1886, the prophet was born, but the treaty has been, what, almost 100 years? Mm-hmm. Now the prophet born, and you tell me about a Peace and Friendship Treaty that tells you that you got to be on a damn boat. Then when you get to shore, you can be ran. That's how I heard the brothers feel. I said, young man, let me tell you this here. When you get to shore, I'll bond you out. If you can prove you're born. Huh? I had to whoop that snigger's name, Lord Abbey. Lord Abbey, he can't call me in my house trying to debate with me. Well, you know, reading it right. I said, don't it say when you get to the shore, nigga? What do you have? You got to get to shore. It says when you get to shore, you can be ransomed. Where in the hell are you? Because there wasn't no airplanes right now. Yeah. They had TWA back then, didn't they, sir? So if you're on the ship, this way you get the sand from any meaty mighty mo, catch a nigga by his toe, holler's nationality level. Now, they say that in Canada. They used to say that in Great Britain. Now you say any meaty mighty mo, catch a man by his toe, right? You don't even know where it comes from, Nursery Rhyme. Any meaty mighty mo, catch a nigga by his toe, if he holler's nationality level. No. What is that from? Being on a damn ship. So he's on the ship. On the ship. But on the ship, there's another ship. See, because I had to tell the young man, I said, didn't the prophet say George Washington went over there to the Sultan? And he asked the Sultan for some workers. And the Sultan said, take them Moors down there because they're not paying me taxes. See, we don't even understand it's a different type of Moor than a Moroccan. The Moors went against theirs. See, I had to tell the young monks, you don't know history. I said, young, you know history. There was no such thing as Morocco kingdom or Morocco until 700. When you got 700 AD, you find all these Arabs taking over Morocco under a guy named Idris, I-D-R-I-S, who was kin to Muhammad, who got chased out. The Eastern came down. I said, you don't, your teachers don't know nothing. Elijah Muhammad said, history is best suited to reward you for your research. Moors don't do research, they just do parakeet. What you got? Oh, you say what the teacher French is about Moors. Oh yeah, that's it. But he ain't teaching you nothing. Remember Saturday, Friday, I told you about the parakeet, right? I was watching Jerry Springer. Now Jerry Springer, I was clicking through and stuff. And I seen this parakeet on Jerry Springer. I said, parakeet? I said, what that's about? Because I seen something where people get gerbils stuck up their booties. People, one person got a 38 stuck up his booty, he was in prison. How you get a 38 stuck up your booty? And this other guy, he got a gerbil in his booty. Him and, the other guy, he got his thing stuck in a pipe. So it's had a thing, unusual medical practices or whatever. So anyway, I was watching the parakeet. And the thing was this, the girl went to her girlfriend's house. And while they talked to her girlfriend, the parakeet said, get it, Bob, ooh, 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 Bob, 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 get it, make me come, I'm coming, Bob, I'm coming, Bob. So the woman looked at her and said, what is your parakeet talking about? Oh, he ain't saying nothing. Then he go again, Bob, 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 get it, Bob. Ooh, Bob, I'm coming. Ooh, Bob, I'm coming. So he said, wait a minute. Woman said, wait a minute. My man named Bobby. My man named Bob. Oh, I'm sorry. I didn't mean to hurt your feelings. Who told on her? The parakeet, right? So me and my wife were talking about this. She said, baby, can you use a parakeet in a case? I said, that can be a challenge. Say, I shoot somebody in the house. I shoot. And the guy said, Brother Ryan, don't shoot me. Don't kill me, Brother Ryan. We've been knowing you for all my life. The parakeet turn around and say, what? When the police get there and see the dead body, say, Brother Ryan, Brother Ryan, don't kill me, Brother Ryan. I've been knowing you all my life. Can the parakeet be brought to court? It's a living, breathing, what, take the court. They get gangsters for that, don't they? All day long, gangsters get buzzing. You see, he's on the table. You can't deny the tape, because the tape what? Has no feelings. The tape has no emotion.
No emotion.
The parakeet has no reason to lie on your butt. Just like this woman, the parakeet said, get it, Bob, ooh, Bob, I'm coming, oh, that's it, Bob. And the woman said, all the people, me and you friends, all the people we know named Bob is my man. And she confessed. They was on the show fighting each other. I feel like that's more. Where is somebody saying it? Yes, the peace and friendship tree. And that's when I was talking with a what you call enigmos?
Enigmos.
Ig for nigger. Mo means confused, mystical.
Enigma.
So these Moors are enigmas.
Yes.
Because they ain't standing on nothing but imagination. So I told Lord Abia, I said, Lord Abia, when you get to the seashore, call me and I may ransom you. And now he tell everybody else, you talk to him now, he say, no, peace and friendship tree, it's not for Moors. I said, how can it be for Moors? Let me show you how dumb people is. They follow these enigma Moors. There you go. The peace and friendship tree, 1789, is signed by American George Washington, some say. But let me go back. My Act 6 tells me of my divine constitution bylaw It has this part, it says, slavery begun in 1779 and ended in 1865, right? Where's 1787 at in there? It's after 1779, right? Who signed the treaty for you, brother? You mean to tell me your leader signed a treaty for you to be free, but he also let you be in slavery too? We don't think. We're not applying applied science to our thinking. We're just parakeet. Get it, Bob. Get it, Bob. We're applying that. That's why I like when me and the boy was up there in Mecca on our hard, he said, and I told him about my professor. He said, you know, Chief, that's contrast and comparison. I said, what? He said, contrast and comparison. The guy had two different colors on. You do not wear plaids and stripes and solid colors together. You know, that's a fashion designer's nightmare. But he contrasts. But you compare his teaching, it superseded the contrast. Here you say you're more, but you're more based on what? What are you more on? What's your ideas as being a more? Contrast and comparison. Here you go, contract. You are Moorish American, but you're not in the temple. You are Moorish American, but you're not under the yoke of Act 6. You are Moorish American, but you're not under the yoke of Act 7. But you are Moorish American. I get people calling me all the time. Well, I'm gonna get my nationality card, claiming I got my paperwork here. Can you sign my paperwork? I'm like, sir, miss, what you mean sign your paperwork? Where did you get that from the prophet Noah Jawali? Well, you don't have to be in the temple to be a Moor. Then why are you trying to be something that the prophet said you can only be if you're in line with Acts 6 and Acts 7? You can't become an American citizen because you hopped over the border and got a Taco Bell and got caught running back. Right. You are an immigrant, an illegal immigrant. How in the hell you become a Moor and you're not in the temple? You ain't stepped before no official in the temple. And everybody in the temple can't make you a Moor. A sheik can't make you a Moor. Listen to what I'm saying. A sheik can't make, a minister can't make you a Moor. An adept can't make you a Moor. You can't be born a Moor. Because the prophet said, with us. He didn't say with your damn mama. He didn't say with your daddy. He didn't say with your brothers and sisters. He said with us. Where we at? In the Moorish active around. You can't say you're a Muslim if there's no one to bear witness that you took the shot at that. Where Brother Rahman at?
Right here.
Come here, Sheikh Rahman.
Oh, no.
No, 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 no.
Please don't.
Now, on his job, come on up here. I want people to see you. Come on up here. I want him to give you his experience. On your job, come on. Chief.
Yes, sir.
On your job, an incident took place where one Muslim made another Muslim, right?
Yes.
What did he do?
He did perform the Shahada thing.
All right, how did he perform?
Like that.
No, but how did he perform?
Oh, he asked me to witness it.
Wait, who?
He asked me to witness it.
He said what?
He asked me to witness it.
He didn't tell you, move on, did he?
No, he said he needed a witness.
Wait a minute. He said he needed a what?
A witness.
He needed somebody to verify that took place.
Yes.
Islam, thank you.
Islam.
These niggas, some of their moles and anybody verified it but another crook. Yeah, I'm a Moorish American. Well, you don't have to be in the temple. So first of all, you get rid of Allah. Here you go. Where's Allah in the temple? What does it say on the card? It says Allah, right?
Islam.
Every national card I see at the top, it says Allah. So you get rid of Allah, so now you're more. But you ain't practicing Islam either because you can't practice Islam without Allah. So ain't none of this on your part because you ain't got more. But you're more. So you say, don't be fooled. Ask him what's in your mind. Now, we have this reading that we read. And I have this read because you can't be a Moorish American without following the prophet's teaching. And this is what it says, prophethood. When it becomes quite clear that a certain person is a true prophet of Allah, the natural result of this realization is that his word should be accepted, his instruction followed, and his orders obeyed. It is unreasonable to accept a man as Allah's true prophet and yet not believe in what he says, nor not to follow what he ordained. You're accepting him as Allah's prophet, meaning you acknowledge that whatever he says is from Allah Almighty. Whatever he does is according with Allah's will and pleasure. Now, disobeying him is the disobeying of Allah, and disobeying Allah leads to nothing but ruin and devastation. Therefore, the very acceptance of a prophet make it incumbent upon you to bow down to destruction and accept him without any hesitation whatsoever. You may not be able to fully grasp the wisdom, uses of this or that order, but the fact that instructions come from the prophet is a significant guarantee for its truth. There can be no room for doubt or suspicion. Your inability to understand it has no reason for having a flawed defect. A common man's understanding is not flawless. It has limitations. It cannot be ignored altogether.
How the hell
you listen to Taj Tariq? Oh, I'm speaking radical. I forgot that. Well, I do speak radical because I'm radical. I'm going to tell the damn truth. When you tell the devil the truth, that's radical. Best you tell the truth in front of somebody else that you're lying to. That's like you let the devil come in your house, tell your children, doo-doo is just as good as brown sugar in the morning. Your child say, well, how is that? And the man say, well, you know, you take the doo-doo, dry it up, bring it up in the morning, put it on the cornflakes. But it's still doo-doo. Say, no, it's brown sugar because it's been transformed. Todd said, you go to, what's that place? The Congress, Library of Congress, right?
Yeah.
You go to the Library of Congress, and where it says AA, it means that you're a certified Moor. Your nationality is certified. Why did the prophet say that on his teaching? Why would we need a prophet if we just go to the Library of Congress? My question is taking out our nationality card. Wait a minute. What do we got? We got our card from where? Oh, we got ours from the National Archives, right? And then the Archives of Congress? Mm-hmm. Okay. Dang, I just thought about it. I'm an AA member. Because I got my card right here from the Library of Congress. Damn, I'm dying. I never thought about that. Let me see. Here you go. I just thought about that. Boom, that in. Ba ba boom. Ba 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 boom. You see?
It's upside down.
It must be upside down on your
camera. It's right up now. Oh, yeah, I see it.
Uh-huh.
I seen the barcode, so I thought.
It says, Library Congress, reader, huh? Ross Adil, a member of the Library of Congress, verified. Now, I got books, right? Now, when I was in prison, well, my younger days, I used to read Hustle, Playboy. No, that's in Congress, too. Mm. So that means Hustle and Congress, Playboy, that makes the cartoon character, Chester the Molester real. Because in Hustle, they got a guy called Chester the Molester. He carried bicycle seats and peppermint sticks. And he tricked your children out. So that makes Chester Molester real, right? All you got to do, all my books are registered in the Library of Congress. But you can't find one book of the prophet registered in the Library of Congress. How come the prophet, because Congress was there then, right? The Library of Congress was there in 1913 through 1929, right? How come the prophet ain't got nothing registered in the Library of Congress? I'm taught by my grandfather who walked and talked to the prophet. He said, go where the prophet went. Stay away from where he didn't go. Pick up what the prophet had. Lay down with somebody else trying to hear. That's the same thing Jesus told Peter in Mark 8, 33. Why are you trying to bring me the stuff of man? What's your problem? What's your issue? What's wrong with you, boy? So I'm writing. This is why I'm writing. In my Quran, it says that John the Baptist stood up and told the king that you killed your brother, married his wife, and now have a relationship and lap dances with his daughter. Mm. That's why John got his head cut off, right? Jesus told the Jews that your father is alive from the beginning. Mm. And the truth was never in. He was right. Mm. So I'm a radical person. Mm. I'm a damn good radical. Because I'm radical against the devil. Mm. Who are you a radical for? I'm a radical for. I had a brother tell me in Detroit. He told me he was a sheep. He said, Brother Ryan, you an agent. I said, yes, sir. He said, you admit that I'm an agent of a lie. He said, I never heard that before. I said, because you're not an agent of a lie. Don't nobody know about James Bond unless you're in opposition, right? Bond, tell you, my name is Bond, James Bond. You got to find out that he's agent, right? Well, you know, when you find out he's agent, he know you're the enemy, don't you? See, because only the enemy know that James Bond is agent. Them people don't know he's agent when he drive up. Hi, right, my name is Bond, James Bond. Don't nobody know that but what the enemy. You know, James Bond is a secret agent for the British government. He's against what we do. So the people that against me, what? Agents for the other side. So when I told the brother, he said, you an agent, brother? I said, yes, I am. Oh, you admit that you agent? I said, yeah, I'm working for my mom. Huh. I got triple sevens in my name. I got seven for the God I follow. I got seven for the government that I'm in. I got seven for the way of life I am. All of it, perfect. 666 means the God that you follow, the government that you support, and the way of life you carry. That's why the queen said this. Who's your God? Huh? What's your way, Islam? Who's your Savior? Ali. Now, any moves on the death thing, you ever see it when you say this is the head of somebody dying? You always see this. When they give them the last right, they do this. Because he's saying what it is. He's saying, who's your God? Ah. What's your way? Islam. Who's your Savior? Ali. Blessed are thou, son. Islam. But you don't know that because people ain't teaching that. Mm. They teach you about the government. They teach you how to have what? White cross, blue sheet. They teach you everything but what you need to know. This is my question to all those punks and fags. When the European go back to Europe, what laws are you going to try to force on me? Simple question. Brother going to tell me, well, you know, you got a resident as a white man, brother. I said, white man, free white man. Remember my brother coming to the temple? And his name was Allah Bay. Mm-hmm. This nigga had the name Allah Bay. And I say, what you gonna do when the European go back here? We follow the prophecy. Prophets say, children, the European gonna let you down. He'll try to take everything with him when he go to Europe. So if he go on to Europe, what the hell are you gonna do? Are you gonna try to make me stay in the house of Jack Bill? But did Jill run down the hill from the house of Jack Bill? Didn't a woman want to get away from what Jack Bill? I don't follow Jack, you do. So I got to end early because I got to take my granddaughter to work because I got to do my job, my duty. But I want y'all to think about that. Who made you? Why did he make you? And what's your relation to the person or the creature or the being that made you? How do you reflect that in your life? I do this way. Allah is one, my prophet. Peace.
It's long.
It's long.
Call him all right, sir. All right, Grand Sheik, is your phone? Oh. There you go.
I'm going to turn it over to Grand Sheik Yusuf Muhammad Bey. Before I do, I want to extend our Islam. He's going to read in charity as we are going to do a collection. For those that's watching us via our live YouTube channel, as well as our phone, you can always extend a benevolence offering. There's no big or smalls. It's just giving what you can and being a reflection of that. And you can go to Cash App, that's MSTA 1928, or you can go through PayPal, which is paypal.me/1928MSTA. And you can also just go directly on our Moorish site at MSTA1928.org on our donation measure, and you can extend a benevolence offering to us. We're going to have our Grand Sheikh Yusuf Muhammad Bey in reading charity, and thus we trust that y'all will extend a motion, a notion, a reflection of benevolence and giving. Islam.
Yeah, because he do contrast.
Islam. Chapter 32, Holy Instructions from the Prophet on Charity. Happy is the man who hath sown in his breast the seeds of benevolence. The produce thereof shall be charity and love. From the fountain of his heart shall rise rivers of goodness, and the stream shall overflow for the benefit of mankind. He assists the poor in their trouble. He rejoiced in furthering the prosperity of all men. He censureth not his neighbor. He believeth not the tales of envy and malevolence. Neither repeateth he their slanders. He forgives the injuries of men. He wiped them from his remembrance. Revenge and malice have no place in his heart. For evil he returneth not evil. He hateth not even his enemies, but requiteth their injustice with a friendly admonition. The griefs and anxieties of men excite his compassion. He endeavoreth to alleviate the weight of their misfortunes, and the pleasure of success rewards his labor. He calmeth the fury, he healeth the quarries of angry men, and prevent the mischiefs of the strife and animosity. He promotes in his neighborhood peace and goodwill, and his name is repeated with praise and benediction. Islam. But now I yield the podium to our governor, Sheikh Jakarta Maccabee, who will read a the warning.
Contrast and comparison.
Islam.
We continue to rise, giving all praises to Allah, giving honors to our holy prophet, Noble Drali. And we camel back off those honors given thus far. To the members of the Moorish Science Temple of America, this is the instructions from your prophet, Noble Drali. Be faithful unto your forefathers' divine and national creed, that you will be blessed for your good deeds that you sow in the flesh. Allah is the one that judges the world, and his judgment is now on. But the weak can comprehend it not. The end of time is drawing near, so says Allah, to his divine prophet, Noble Drali. And that is why many hearts have been turned to stone, and many have eyes to see but cannot see, ears to hear but cannot hear, lest they would be confounded of their sins. These are the trying hours now, dear Moors, and every evil spirit is moving. And they are trying every weak mind to overthrow and drag out the true foundation that has been laid, and to cause confusion in the minds of the ones who believe. But if you have a true love of Allah and the spirit of your forefathers, you fear not what you hear or see, but will sacrifice the utmost of your very life to protect your movement and your prophet. Watch your enemies, dear Moors. Your enemies are the ones that speak against your prophet and ridicule him to the very lowest, and the ones that speak against your divine and national principles of your temples. Act accordingly, and Allah will bless you for your good work. Peace, your divine prophet, Noble Drali. Islam.
Islam.
At this time.
Wait,
I want to
show what's in my wallet.
He's gonna show you what's in his wallet.
Islam.
See, this was in my wallet.
For all those on the video, you'll see what's in the Grand Sheikh's wallet.
Islam.
What's in your wallet?
Just a reminder.
Okay, I gotta get out of here.
Islam. At this time, we'll be calling up the mother of the temple, Sheikhess Fatima Razvan Bey, as she will be Lord in the meeting for us in prayer. Islam.
Islam. Islam.
Praises to Allah and honors to the Prophet if everyone will rise. Two on the right, five on the left in representations of our law. Allah, bind our hearts and minds back to our ancient forefathers, divine creed and principles. This we ask in our holy name and of the seven Elohim. Amen.
Amen.
Islam.